Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Dechert seminar called GDPR for HR. Don't scoff, please. We're very proud of that title. It took us a long time to come up with something relevant and rhyming. Now, it's a pretty full house tonight, so just to check, can people who are sitting right at the back put their hands up in the air if you can hear me? Gosh, that's reassuring. Excellent. So my name is Jason Butswick. I'm one of the partners in the employment team here at Dechert, and I'm joined by Maddie White, who's one of our rising star associates in our IP team, and Jenny McGrandall, whose star has already risen and is a senior associate in our employment team. I know normally, for those who've been to Dechert seminars before, we drag you into this room, we plied you with lukewarm tea and coffee. We then lecture you non-stop for an hour, sometimes longer, and display dubious slides with clip art on them. And today we're going to do something completely different. First, possibly in a vain attempt to bring culture and civilization to our dry lawyers' lives, each member of the panel has composed a GDP haiku, a Japanese-style poem of five syllables, seven syllables, five syllables. And people didn't realize GDPR lends itself perfectly to the form of haiku. I'm going to store this up, and we'll go through the haikus at the end of the session, and you can vote upon which is the preference. Obviously, I should win, but we'll see. And the mic will be open. If anybody from the audience wants to compose their own haiku during the session, you're welcome to come up and compete. If we have too many haikus, we haven't done a good job, but that's fine. Second, there's going to be no lecture. There's going to be no slides. We're going to have Jenny, Maddie, and I a GDPR chat. It was going to be a fireside chat, but there are health and safety reasons for not doing that. So it's just a chat around our glass table. It's the sort of conversation that Dechert lawyers have all the time. Our lives are very prosaic. It's not Boston law or Ally McBeal here or suits. And in the chat, my job will be to ask Jenny and Maddie certain questions so that I learn and you learn everything you need to know from a practical perspective to be ready for GDPR on the 25th of May 2018. And for those of you who like to make notes on your seats, you will have a booklet. It has some bios, an extraordinarily long bio for me for reasons that beyond understanding, and shorter bios for the others, and then a series of blank slides with big questions. And you can fill in the notes under the questions. But if you don't like taking notes, don't despair, because everyone here will get a going home present. They'll be available at reception when you leave, which will be those very same slides filled with our suggested answers and reminders of the pearls of wisdom that Jenny and Maddie will be sharing during this session. If you flick now to the blank slides and look at the first big question, you'll see it is, what do we need to know? Slightly bigger question, perhaps, than we had anticipated. And we're going to limit it to what you need to know about GDPR. And that's what we're going to discuss over the next 50 minutes or so. I'm definitely going to finish by 6. It's going to be aimed at having a practical overview. In the meantime, the short answer is this. It comes into force on the 25th of May 2018. It's going to come into force with a bang. There's no grace period. There's no transition period. You have to be ready. Second, consent as a basis for processing personal data, if it ever was a proper basis, which is doubtful, probably isn't going to be the basis to process personal data for employees going forward. So we need to work out what other lawful basis there will be, or bases there will be, to process data. Data subjects, and for that we mean employees in an HR context, will have significantly enhanced rights. This includes a right to information, information about the personal data that you store, that you process, and why you're processing it. And that's going to be in a privacy notice. There was some debate about it was a privacy notice, but we ended up with privacy. If there is a breach, there will be strict notification requirements. And the regulator has finally been given a proper set of teeth. Real eye-watering fines are now possible. So let's start with fines. Jenny, it seems to me every time there's a ping on my inbox, it's an email from a consultant of some sort, telling me that GDPR Armageddon is upon me, and unless I engage their services, which in my mind is like a SWAT team of people in combat pants and camouflage paint on their faces, but unless I do something like that, I'm going to be faced with 20 million euro fines or 4% of global turnover, and this is very worrying, and should I worry?
Well, I hope to allay some of those concerns today. If any of you are as sad as I am, you might have read the ICO blog. And the first post on that blog was written by the Information Commissioner, Elizabeth Denham, herself, and it was on the subject of fines. And she was seeking in that article to make people worry less about fines. There's obviously been a lot, as Jason said, in the press about that. And in this post, she states that the ICO remains committed to guiding, advising, and educating organisations. It's more about a carrot than a stick approach, although it is quite hard to see what the carrot is in all of this.
Very sharp.
She also seeks to reassure readers that powers will be used proportionately and judiciously. And I think to get all this into perspective, it's worth remembering that of 17,300 cases that went to the ICO last year, only 16 of those resulted in fines. I think it's also important to remember that, of course, if your organisation does get caught up in a data breach, really the fine is going to be the least of your worries. The potential adverse press is going to be much more of a concern. So in short, I don't think we should be getting too hung up about the fines. Although, of course, if you're seeking to cajole people in the business to get into gear and assist with your GDPR compliance programme, then it may be a very good idea to remind them of the possible fines.
Are there any guidelines? Is there any criteria? Is there anything we can point to and say, here's what's going to happen on a fine?
Yes. The Article 29 Working Party has come up with a set of guidelines which it suggests will be taken into account. And so the regulator will look at the nature of the breach, how serious it was. Was it deliberate or negligent? Have there been previous breaches? Was the correct notification procedure followed? Did the organisation seek to take any steps to mitigate the harm that had been caused? And what categories of data were affected?
So a breach happens. How you respond is just as important to whether you're going to get a fine and how much it is.
I think that's absolutely right. And of course, covering it up completely is likely to result in the higher fines.
Okay, so I feel a bit better about the fines. So now I come on to the next question, which is, previously, all our contracts, they've got these consent clauses and we rely upon those clauses. And I know there's been some chat about you can't rely upon consent, words like explicit and freely given and withdrawable and all those sorts of things. But why can't I just stick a consent clause in my contract? They're signing it, they don't have to join me. Won't it work?
I think it would take a very bold employer to rely on consent after the 25th of May. The ICO has been very clear in its guidance that employers should not use consent. And that's on the basis that it cannot be freely given because there is unequal negotiating power between employer and employee. In any event, I'm not so sure that employers would want to rely on consent because consent can be withdrawn and you have to advise employees of that fact. So that can be problematic. And also you have to keep records of consent. So that's just an extra layer of record keeping that you could, I'm sure, well do without.
Okay. What about the contracts I've already got? What about all those contracts I've already signed? Can I rely upon them?
Well, up until the 24th of May, yes, but after that, no.
Okay, so I can't rely on consent. How am I going to process their information?
Well, again, I don't think this is as much of a problem as perhaps people have believed. So I think there are three possible bases for processing that employers can rely upon. The first is that it's necessary for the performance of the contract with the data subject. So, for example, if you're processing their bank account details in order that you can pay them, which I doubt any employee would object to in any event, or if it's necessary for compliance with a legal obligation.
Something like keeping working time records for the working time regulations.
Exactly. Okay. But not all categories of data will fall within those two bases. To take as an example, appraisal forms. Obviously, there's no legal obligation to appraise your employees, and nor is it necessary for the performance of the contract. So that sort of category of data is likely to fall under where processing is necessary for the purposes of the legitimate interests pursued by the controller, except where such interests are overridden by the data subject's interests or fundamental rights and freedoms.
So, okay, I see we can just say legitimate interests. And if we take a view that it's more important than their freedoms and rights, can we just rely upon that, or do we have to do more?
No, nothing is straightforward under the GDPR. So once you've decided that you're going to rely on legitimate interests, for each category of personal data, and I think there can be broad categories, you have to specify precisely what your legitimate interest is. And that information has to go into the privacy notice that you referred to earlier. But okay. more than that, one thing you'll hear us talking about again and again today is record keeping. That is an essential part of GDPR. And I think if you're relying on legitimate interests, then you're actually also going to have some record of the fact that you've gone through that balancing exercise to work out if you are causing some harm to the fundamental rights and freedoms of your employees. So to take as an example the appraisal form, well, employers do have a legitimate interest in processing appraisal forms. Of course they do, because you need those to monitor employees' performance, to justify promotions, pay increases, etc. But you can see that there is the potential for causing harm to the rights and freedoms of employees, because obviously that is very confidential, sensitive, not in the sensitive personal data sense of the word, information that employees would not want to be widely disseminated through the organisation. But I think as long as you are keeping those appraisal forms securely, as long as you're limiting where those are sent, that's to do with the principle of minimization, which is another key principle under GDPR, then I don't see that the employer's interests, or rather the employee's interests, are not going to be outweighed by the employer's.
Okay, I see that. So we can process to perform the contract if we've got a lawful or a legal requirement, or if it's for a legitimate purpose. And once we've got our basis, then we're fine, right? We can just keep that information forever.
No. Another key part of GDPR, which actually is already in existence under the Data Protection Act, is this principle of not keeping data for longer than you need to. So you absolutely must have a policy which sets out clearly what your retention periods are for certain categories of data. And that's all, again, part of this record keeping. But more than that, you must ensure that your employees are actually adhering to these retention periods. That's key.
Okay. So I've also read a bit about something called special categories of data. What are special categories of data?
Well, special categories of data, or special category data, which is marginally easier to say, is actually very similar to what we currently call sensitive personal data. So it's data revealing racial or ethnic origin, philosophical or religious belief, trade union membership, political opinions, and also data concerning health, sex life, or sexual orientation. But it now also includes genetic or biometric data, which I would imagine wouldn't concern most employers, at least I hope not. And it also no longer includes data relating to criminal convictions or offences. They're dealt with under a separate article of the GDPR, and that basically states that you should not be processing that kind of data unless it's permitted under national law. And actually what our data protection bill has done is opt to treat it in exactly the same way as special category data.
Oh, so it is special category.
Basically, yes.
I see, okay.
Under our law.
So what is so special about special category data? I mean, for example, you mentioned medical information. If I need to process medical information to for medical insurance purposes for my staff or to pay sick pay, can't I just rely on the fact that it's necessary for the contract or it's a legitimate purpose?
No, for special category data, it's not enough to satisfy one of the Article 6 bases of processing. you also have to go on and satisfy one of the conditions under Article 9. And having looked at those, I think really there is only one that is going to be of general use to employers, and that's the one where it is necessary for the purposes of carrying out the obligations and exercising specific rights of the data controller in the field of employment and social security law. Nothing is short and snappy under GDPR. So to go back to your example of sickness absence records, I think that that would fall under that category, because obviously employers are under an obligation to pay their employees sick pay, whether it's contractual or statutory, and they're going to need that data in order to do that. And also, if the employee is disabled, you need to process that data in order to establish whether you might be under a duty to make reasonable adjustments as required under the Equality Act.
Well, let's say that all makes sense, but let's say an employee at work is using your system and they're having a social chat with another employee, and in that social chat they disclose or they share special category information about another individual. Is that going to be permitted or is that not permitted? I mean, how does an employer deal with that?
I think that's a very good question, and it's a very real problem. I don't think that is going to fall within any of the headings in Article 9. I think that the best thing an employer can do is to ensure that it has a detailed data privacy policy, that it does actually communicate to its employees, and perhaps it's evidence that it's communicated it to employees. And in that, it should specify that you should not be using work email for that sort of content, that you should be using your personal email for that sort of content. And employees should also be aware, if it is the case that you're monitoring emails, that you are doing that. And in that instance, I can't really see that the ICO would criticise an employer if, in fact, its email systems are being used to transmit special category data.
So there's a lot to check and monitor and oversee. And I've been reading, Maddie, about data protection officers. When does an employer need a data protection officer?
So the GDPR tells us that an employer needs a data protection officer when your core activities consist of processing operations which require regular and systematic monitoring of data subjects on a large scale.
That is absolutely crystal clear.
Indeed.
What do they mean by core activities?
So we get a little bit of help in the GDPR recitals about core activities. So recital 97 quite helpfully says it's your primary activities and not ancillary, which doesn't get us much further. So the Article 29 Working Party have had a look at this quite recently, and they say that it means your key operations to achieve your objectives. They also give an example of, for instance, a hospital. A hospital has to process health data in order to provide its services. It couldn't provide its services without processing your health data. Support activities such as paying your employees or having IT support are classed as ancillary, so they won't count as your core activities.
So, Dechert, our core activity is putting on entertaining seminars and occasionally doing legal work, but it's not processing payroll data. Or so would we need a data protection officer?
No, not under current thinking.
So I don't have to worry about having anybody responsible for data protection, is that right?
No, we definitely still need someone to think about it. So even if you decide that you don't need an official data protection officer under the GDPR, you should still think about assigning those responsibilities to a certain person within your organisation, whether that's someone in risk or compliance, sorry to anyone from those teams in the room. You still need someone to be thinking about it, but you should be very careful about what you call them and how you structure the role, because you wouldn't want to accidentally appoint a DPO when you've decided you don't need one, because there's lots of things that you as the employer have to provide to the data protection officer. So they need active support from senior management, they need financial support, staff, infrastructure such as IT, and they need continuous training as well. So if you are going to have one, that's quite a lot of obligations on you as well as on the DPO.
So let's say let's say our core activity is in fact processing personal data, and let's say it's large scale and it's systematic and all those other phrases. So we have to point to DPO, and somehow we drew straws, and I got the shortest straw, typically. So I'm the data protection officer, and I've expressed some dissatisfaction with, you know, the planned proposal to publicize embarrassing medical information about our staff on the internet. So do I have any protections then if I raise my concerns? I say, we're not going to do that.
So if you're taking a particularly risk-averse approach as a DPO, and your organisation doesn't agree with that, your organisation is still forbidden from dismissing you or penalising you if it's in connection with your performance of your role as the DPO. So if you're being particularly risk-averse, organisation doesn't agree, they still can't penalise you or dismiss you for it because it's just the performance of your role.
That's if you're a DPO.
If you're a DPO.
So Jenny, let's say we don't have a DPO, but we've assigned the responsibility to someone else and they've raised a concern about this practice of putting medical information on the internet, and then they're picked on or dismissed. Do they have any protections?
Well, I'd imagine in those circumstances, they might have a whistleblowing claim. Right.
Which would be potentially unlimited compensation. Okay. So that's pretty clear. The other thing I've heard about, and it's related to fines, is there's an obligation to notify when there is a data breach. So Maddie, what is a data breach?
Well, the GDPR tells us that a breach is a breach of security which leads to accidental or unlawful destruction, loss, alteration, unauthorized disclosure of, or access to personal data that you're processing.
So, okay, so any loss or any mistaken email to the wrong party, you've got to notify. Right?
Not necessarily. So there's still a distinction here as well under the GDPR. So even if you have a personal data breach, it may not be notifiable. It depends on whether or not there is a risk to the risk to the individual's rights and freedoms. So for instance, if you've got an encrypted USB stick, not a CD, we're going modern, and your employee has left this encrypted USB stick on a train, but you've got backup copies of data that was on that USB stick, then it's probably not going to be too much of a risk to the individual's data who are on that USB stick. It's encrypted. You've got the encryption key. It's unlikely that someone's going to be able to access that data, and you've got adequate backup copies, so the data hasn't been permanently lost.
And what's the test again? Risk of?
Just a risk.
Okay. So I leave, I'm old school, I've got a CD and it's unencrypted. I've left it on a train and it's got payroll information, it's got people's national insurance numbers. Do you think I have to notify?
Yes, probably.
Okay, I've now encrypted it.
Okay, have you got backups?
I haven't got backups.
You still need to notify.
Okay, but I found a backup.
Handy. You might be okay, but you have to kind of look at the exact circumstances and depends what was on it.
Let's say I email some salary information to the wrong person within the firm. Yeah? But I ask them, or outside, but to my lawyer, in fact. I say to them, I phone them up and I say, look, ooh, sent you my mistake, can you please destroy it? And they say, yes, no problem, I'm going to destroy it. Is that notifiable?
It depends how quickly you realised. The fact that it's to a lawyer is probably helpful because they've got their own professional obligations as it is, so yeah. You probably can trust them to destroy it.
Okay, so actually it wasn't a lawyer, it was a legal journalist.
Probably a risk that you should notify.
Okay, and what if the information was, I don't know, information about sexual orientation, would that make a difference?
I think in that instance, again, it depends who you're sending it to, it depends how many people's data it's about, depends how severe the consequences to them would be. Would it result in discrimination to them, depending on who you've sent it to?
So that, I mean, it sounds to me like sort of situation where you have to look at the breach, you have to assess the breach on a case-by-case basis, and then decide whether to notify.
Yeah.
And if you do decide you should notify, how long do you have?
72 hours.
When?
From when you become aware that there has been a breach. Awareness, very helpfully, is said to be when you have a reasonable degree of certainty that a security incident has occurred. So So, for example, if you lose a USB stick, you're deemed to be aware as soon as you know that the USB stick has been lost. So you need to make sure that all your employees are well aware of procedures of what to do if they do lose an item with personal data on it. So you need to have a very clear data security breach procedure and policy, which needs to be regularly communicated to employees. Perhaps you could have a sort of annual system where employees have to go through and physically scroll down, and before they can click agree, yeah, I've read the policy.
So I'm assuming that having a completely lax system where no one knows how many USB sticks there happen to be in the organisation and therefore can't work out if they've left one on the train or not is not going to be a complete answer.
No, you should probably try and work out what stuff you've got.
Okay, very good. Jenny, we've heard now that there's a... that's another question I had. Let's say we've decided we need to report it to the ICO. Do we have to report it to anyone else?
You might need to report it to the data subjects who have been affected, but that depends on whether or not there's a high risk to their rights and freedoms.
There's a higher test?
Yeah, slightly higher.
So we might have to report to the ICO, but we don't have to tell the individual?
Not unless it's a high risk to them.
Okay. But there is a possibility that we have to tell the data subject
about a breach. Yeah, as well.
Okay, so there's a new right then, presumably, maybe it's an existing right, but a new right to notify data subject of a breach. There's also an existing right to access, which we've all come across, the dreaded subject access request. Jenny, is that going to continue in GDPR, and if so, is it in the same form? Are there changes? What's it going to look like?
Unfortunately, yes, it's here to stay, and in fact, people are suggesting that there will be more subject access requests under GDPR. That's in part because you have to notify employees of their right to bring a subject access request in a privacy notice, and also because there is no longer a need to pay £10. So that may encourage more people. But I think there is a small piece of good news that we can cling to in all of this, and that is that currently the time period for compliance is 40 days. Under the new regime, it's 30 days, but you can extend that by 2 months where necessary, given the complexity and number of requests. And there is no need to get the consent of the data subject to have that extra 2 month period. You simply need to write to the data subject during the first month after receipt and explain why that there's been a delay.
Okay. So is there any circumstance where you can say, no, I'm just not going to comply?
Yes, if the request is manifestly unfounded or excessive. No real guidance as to what that actually means, but I think... if nothing else, given recent case law, it is going to be in really exceptional circumstances that you are going to be able to refuse to comply. And I think from the language of the GDPR, it seems that really it's in the situation where you're getting repeated requests for the same data that you're going to be able to refuse to comply.
So if the request comes in and it involves an enormously disproportionate review of gigabytes of data, is there anything we can do? Is there anything that an employer can do to try and slow it down or deal with this? Is we're just facing 3 months of hard slog?
I think there is. The ICO has revised its guidance in the wake of cases that came out earlier this year that many of you, I'm sure, will have heard of, the Deer and Oxford University and the Taylor Wessing cases. And that says that it's a good thing for the parties to have an open dialogue and to try and reach some kind of compromise as to what data should be provided. So I think it's perfectly acceptable and in fact is probably will stand you in good stead subsequently if you write to the data subject and say, look, what is it that you are really after? We think it's X, and we would suggest, therefore, that we look at this time period and we search these custodians and we use these keywords. And more often than not, actually, the data subject will agree to that.
And quite often, we find, my experience has been, the data subject access request is accompanied by a grievance or a complaint or litigation, and the purpose isn't really to rectify things that are wrong, but to try and find some smoking gun to help their case. Is there any basis to say, well, look, that's not a proper basis to ask for a data subject access request? You know, just, you know, it's excessive or it's unfounded, we're not going to comply?
No, unfortunately not. Those cases I referred to earlier have made it quite clear that that's not a reason for rejecting a subject access request. They are purpose blind, to use the terminology that the courts used. However, it is a factor that can be taken into account when the court is exercising its discretion as to whether or not to order compliance with a subject access request.
So this is the sort of, this sounds to me like an area where there's going to continue to be dispute over what constitutes manifestly unfounded or excessive, and presumably a dispute over how much you can charge, because I understood from what you said earlier that it's not just a question of saying no, you could say yes, but I'm going to charge you for the privilege of having this information.
Absolutely right, although, again, from looking at the GDPR, it seems that it's only, well, it's going to be in exceptional circumstances, and it's administrative charges, so I would imagine things like photocopying, you're not going to be able to charge for the time you've spent on your lawyers, for example, reviewing the thousands of emails that have come up as a result of the subject access request.
Excellent time spent nonetheless. So, okay, we've heard a bit about, we know about the, we've heard a bit about right to notification of breaches, and we know about the right of access. Are there any other rights out there? Because I've heard about a right to be forgotten, and a right of objection, and a right of restriction, and how do they all fit together?
Well, that's not easy, and you do need to put a cold towel over your head and look at the GDPR to try to work it all out. But essentially, they stem from the right of objection, and actually, the right of objection only applies where you're relying on legitimate interests as your ground for processing. So it's not going to apply to data which you're having to process for a legal obligation or because it's necessary for the performance of the contract. So that's quite helpful. And it also will not apply if the data controller has compelling legitimate grounds for the processing which override the interests, rights and freedoms of the data subject, or if the controller needs to process the data to establish, exercise, or defend a legal claim. So I think that in many instances, an employer is going to knock back a request for some kind of restriction of the way in which data is being processed on those grounds, that so it has a legitimate interest or that it needs it to defend a legal claim.
So it may not be, these rights may not be as helpful as would seem if you are in a dispute scenario.
I think that's right. That's my reading of the GDPR. I think there's been a lot of unnecessary scaremongering.
So one thing I wanted to ask you about was references. In certain industries, references are a requirement. In particular, it's going to be the case, or is the case, for some financial services companies, it will be the case for most. There is an obligation to provide a reference. If an individual is not happy with the reference they're being provided, I mean, I can see a world in which they're going to say, please, restrict them from sending out this reference while I object to their ability to send out the reference. Would that be an alternative to running to court?
I don't think so, because again, there's an exclusion to this right if the data controller needs to process the data to comply with the legal obligation. And in the scenario you've just given, obviously the employer is obliged to provide a regulatory reference. It's going to need that personal data in order to write the reference.
Okay, so moving on, what about another right, the right to information? So what does that entail?
Well, the key thing for employers is that from May 2018, you're going to have to provide your employees with a privacy notice. And I think that's not something that employers generally provide at the moment, because you generally rely on the information that's in the contract of employment. And the privacy notice has to contain information that is set out in the GDPR. So it has to specify what the purpose is for the processing and what your legal bases are. If you're relying on legitimate interests, which I referred to earlier, you have to specify what those legitimate interests are.
Before we get into the detail, though, is there a particular format? I mean, does it have to be in writing? Does it have to be written in triplicate? Does it have to be written in blood? Is there any? Can you just tell them?
Well, I wish I knew the answer to that, because it would make the drafting of the privacy notice, which I'm trying to do at the moment, a lot easier. It doesn't have to be written, because, of course, there will be some instances in which, not so much in the employment context, but where you're giving that information over the phone. But I think in the employment context, you're clearly going to want it to be written. And I would imagine what I think employers should be doing is that you should be sending that to employees, on an annual basis, and probably at the same time then referring them to all the other key policies, like the breach notification policy, and probably getting them to attest to the fact that they've read and understood it.
Two questions from there. One is there an obligation to do this annually? But also, when was the first time you have to tell them?
No obligation to do it annually, although you are under an obligation to, if the information changes, to send it again.
So if you're processing more data for a different purpose.
Exactly. Okay. Or if you're transferring it to another third party.
I'm going to ask you about that soon.
And I've forgotten the other question you asked.
Sorry. When's the first time you have to give it to them?
At the point of collection, which I think is another potential problem for employers. So obviously for your existing employees, I'd imagine what you'll do is send that privacy notice probably on or around the 25th of May, unless you're super duper organised and you send it before then. But for new recruits, I think the question is a bit trickier, because actually you will start gathering data from a candidate at quite an early stage, and actually often even before the interview. I think it's possibly a bit, I think there will need to be some kind of privacy notice that goes to people at that stage, although maybe it comes from the recruitment consultant if you're using a recruitment consultant. But otherwise, I think at the very least, you should be sending the privacy notice to new employees at the point at which you make the offer.
Yeah, but I mean, if we've got a potential recruit, we're taking information from candidates to assess them for a role, then we've got to give them a privacy notice at that stage too.
Arguably, yes, although it'll obviously be a much shorter version than the one that's going to your employees.
And what if we want to hold that information, they don't get the job, we want to hold that information on our systems?
I think in that scenario, it probably would be acceptable to obtain their consent, and that's probably the best way of having a lawful basis to process the data. And obviously, if they're not happy with the fact that you're keeping hold of their CV, then they can withdraw that consent or not give it in the first place.
And Maddie, what about the situation where we actually make the decisions, because we're a global organisation, like lots of the organisations here, and we're making decisions outside the UK? So we want to transfer personal data outside the UK. That's fine, I take it.
No. Well, you can, as long as you're complying with the GDPR. As part of that, whichever option you choose out of the number of options that GDPR gives, as Jenny was just saying, they do have to be informed of where their data is going. So if you are transferring their data to the US for central processing, for example, they need to be told in that privacy notice.
Okay.
In terms of options, though, so you've got things like an adequacy decision from the European Commission. That covers countries like Switzerland, New Zealand, Canada, and also some slightly more bizarre countries such as Uruguay and Andorra. Or you can look to safeguards, which are binding corporate rules and model clauses, which I'll come back to in a second. Or your main derogations that you're looking for under GDPR are consent and necessary for the performance of a contract. But as we've been discussing throughout, consent is not really going to be, you can't really rely on that in the employment context. So that crosses that one off for transfers as well. And necessary for the performance of a contract, it's probably not actually necessary for you to transfer your employees' data to a different country in order to perform your contract with them. So it's probably safer to rely on the model clauses, for instance, under the safeguards.
Okay, so I'm going to do some central HR processing in the US. What's the route I'm going to do?
I think model clauses, which will be the route that a lot of people in this room are perhaps taking at the moment, and certainly the route that a lot of our clients have gone down.
And model clauses are clauses drafted by?
The European Commission. So the European Commission has put together these standard clauses, which if you use them in the exact form that they have published them, they provide you with this kind of protection for transferring data abroad. because it puts the data importer in the other country under the same obligations that you are in the EEA. So it protects the data subject's rights.
So I can't change any aspect of them?
You can't change anything fundamental to the data subject. You can add commercial, purely commercial clauses to do with you and your, say, head office in the US.
So I want my head office to be responsible for any claims or costs or to indemnify me, I can put that in?
Yeah, as long as you're not contradicting anything fundamental to the data subject, that's fine.
And then are we going to have to rely upon model clauses for information that's sent to the UK as from the end of March 2019?
Hopefully not. We'll have to do a lot of more Brexit watch this space. But the UK is probably going to be going for an adequacy decision. The UK government doesn't want to interrupt any data flows between the UK and the EU, and an adequacy decision would be the best way to do that. We have already committed to bringing in the GDPR, and the UK Data Protection Bill essentially just transposes the GDPR into it anyway. So we're probably going to be looking for an adequacy decision.
Okay. Thank you both very much. I said earlier that I was going to ask you both to guide us through how we prepare practically for GDPR. So I just want to see if you can help me now put together the sort of step plan that we need to do. And I'm assuming from what you said earlier, Maddie, that the first step would be get an individual, or better still, get a team, a project team, to help you ensure you're compliant.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. That sounds easy-ish, probably not as easy as it will be in practice, but I've got my team. What do they do, first of all?
I think the first thing that they need to do is work out what data you have and where it is, which perhaps sounds easier than it is in practice. Maddie and I have been involved in a lot of that sort of work with clients, and we have a questionnaire that we've been giving clients. They go away and fill that in, give it to obviously everyone within the business who's likely to know where the data is and what they're doing with it. And then we analyse those results.
What, you analyse it and produce a report? And
we produce a gap analysis so that we highlight for the clients the areas of greatest concern which they need to address before next May.
So number one, I get my project team. Number two, I do my data mapping and I produce a gap analysis. So I work out where there are sort of holes and I understand what data I have and what I'm processing. And then I rely on consent. No?
Well, no, I don't think that's a good idea. So you then have to work out what your lawful bases for processing are going to be and if it's legitimate interests, what those are, and carry out that balancing exercise that I talked about earlier.
Okay. So number one, project team. Number two, data mapping and gap analysis. Number three, work out my lawful processing basis if it's legitimate purposes. Conduct a balancing act between the legitimate interests or legitimate purposes against the rights and freedoms of the individuals. Okay, so I've done that. It's taken me, you know, a little bit of time. We haven't yet produced any documents or looked at any documents. Do I need to, are there any particular documents I should be thinking about? Should I be looking at them? Is that my next step? Maddie?
You need to have a look at all your third-party contracts. So if you've got, for instance, payroll providers, benefits providers, you need to be looking at all those contracts. It's very unlikely that any of them will be GDPR compliant at the moment. You need to be looking at those, putting in place GDPR compliant clauses to go in data processing contracts. In particular, one of the main things to look at is a breach notification clause. Because if your processors have a data breach with your personal data, they need to be informing you of that immediately or at the latest within 24 hours. Because when they become aware, under the current Article 29 Working Party guidelines, you also become aware. So if they don't tell you until after 72 hours is up, technically you have failed to notify within the 72 hours.
Okay, other things we need to look at, policies, retention policies, Jenny?
Yes, well, I think the first thing perhaps is the contract of employment. Personally, I think you should be stripping out all anything to do with data protection from the contract of employment, which would make it a lot shorter.
Take out my
other
consent
than
clauses?
Definitely the consent clauses.
Do I need to go through some sort of variation process for that?
No, I don't think so. I think the best thing is, as I said earlier, just send out your privacy notice, and perhaps, you know, there'll be a short cover email with that, which says we are no longer relying on
consent to process your data, please read the attached, which explains, you know, why we're processing your data. I think in the contract of employment, it should really say nothing more than please refer to the privacy notice, which is included in your pack and on the intranet, and make sure you read XYZ policies.
Make sure you comply with our policy on data privacy yourself.
Comply, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
And then, yes, you're right. Obviously, you need to either GDPRize existing policies, if you have them, or draft policies. So you need a good and thorough data privacy policy. You need the breach notification policy. You need a retention policy.
We need privacy notices.
Yes.
And will we need some sort of protocol or procedure for dealing with breach notifications?
Yeah, you need to make sure you've got a full written procedure so that employees know exactly what they need to do if they come across a breach and how to recognise the breach.
Okay, so I've got my project team. I've done my data mapping and I've got my gap analysis. I've worked out my lawful basis for processing, including the interest behind my legitimate purpose. I've done my balancing act, which is a bit tricky. I've updated my contracts, I've updated my policies, I've introduced a retention policy, I've checked my third-party contracts with data processors, I've included specific wording about notifying me of breaches, I've sent out my privacy notices and said I'm not relying upon consent anymore, and I've drawn up a protocol for dealing with data privacy breaches. Note for me, because this is close to my heart, I probably want to check my insurance policy to make sure I'm covered for those potential claims that come in. I know it's not probably going to help me with a fine. It may not even help me with the reputation issues, but it might help me with some costs if we do have a data breach. But I can feel that there's something missing.
I would suggest you also have to look at training your employees. There are a lot of online providers out there who are frantically updating their program to include data protection training. And, you know, if nothing else, then that, you know, that is better than nothing. But I think there has to be a certain amount of personalised training that you give to your employees, because they, you know, you have to tell them what you're doing with their data and why you're doing it, and you're not going to get that from an online provider. And you also have to emphasise the importance to them of notifying breaches, and they have to understand who they have to contact in that sort of scenario. They have to understand who the data protection officer or equivalent is. So I think really, there's no substitute for actually having some personal training.
Okay, so in summary, I've got to put together my project team, which will be involving short straws. I may or may not have to appoint a data protection officer, but the project team or someone in there will have some responsibilities. I'm going to do the mapping of my data, and I'm going to do my gap analysis. And then I'm going to look at the lawful basis of processing all this data, including doing a balancing act if it's a legitimate purpose exercise. And then I'm going to update existing documents, including third-party provider documents, including my contracts, including introducing or updating privacy policies and data protection policies, introducing a retention policy. And I'm going to send out my privacy notices, which will be drafted and tailored to our particular business. And I'm going to draw up some sort of protocol or procedure for dealing with data breaches. I'm going to check my insurance cover. I'm going to train all my staff. I'll be quite tired at that point. And I may want to look for help elsewhere. So how can we help? Well, if you do want help from us, we can do all the things that Jenny and Maddie have said. So we can help you map the data. We can do the gap analysis and help you plug what you need to. We can help you the drafting of privacy notices, although you want to beware being too legalistic in those, and with the policies and the breach reporting protocol, etc. And we can help you design and even deliver training if you wish. I said I'd finish by 6. I've still got a few minutes left. Enough time at least for haikus. Also time, if we don't have time for questions now, for questions afterwards over drinks. And I'm delighted to introduce a GDP an expert from our Paris office in Le GDPR. And if you have any questions for her, which she only speaks French. No, she doesn't. She speaks English fluently. Then she's also going to be available for drinks afterwards. I'm happy to introduce you. Please do complete your feedback forms. Be very helpful to us to understand, you know, whether this sort of session is helpful and the format and whether it works. Those forms are probably the last forms we'll issue which don't have privacy notices attached, so enjoy that moment. Finally, whilst you are filling out your forms, we just got time for our haiku competition. So haiku number one. For GDPR, ask, is it reasonable and keep a record. High cue number two, data personal and processing unlawful, tell the ICO. And then high cue three, which actually has an alternative ending, exporting data requires not ambivalence, but equivalence or model clauses. So we'll have a quick vote. Who votes haiku one? Raise your hand. I thought haiku one was best, personally. Haiku two, roughly the same number. And haiku three, oh, Maddie, well done. Excellent. So thank you very much. Do fill in your form. And don't forget, completed and filled out slides are available to collect when you leave on reception. And we'll be waiting just afterwards to if you can join us for a drink. Thank you to Maddie White. Thank you to Jenny McGrandall. Thank you all for listening. And I hope you've learnt something useful today. Thank you.